Cool. Okay. Chapter 5, Docker for Data Science. Very exciting chapter for reasons you'll find out shortly. But we want to learn how to decide if a container is the right tool for a job, how to download and run pre-built Docker images, how to describe the stages of the Docker container lifecycle, and build simple Docker files for your own projects. I keep saying Docker, but really it's just containers in general. So why containers? Common problem, you go, it works on my machine. And then someone else goes, but it doesn't work on my machine. And it's like, okay, well then we'll just ship your machine. And that's how you get Docker. It's just, you're shipping the whole machine rather than just code. And so you're saving an entire machine state rather than just the project components. And this can extend beyond packages and libraries to like the R or Python version itself, or as far down as like the base operating system. If you can't really like simulate the hardware, but you can go all the way down to the operating system. And while it is similar to a virtual machine, they're usually more single purpose. They're quick to start and can be used for individual projects or scripts. And the container's configuration is code, infrastructure is code. And so it's easy to reproduce. You're not saving like a whole ISO file like you would with like VirtualBox in a true virtual machine. And so why containers for data science? It's good for packaging an environment for someone else to use and packaging a finished product. So if it's a project, an app, whatever you made, for archiving, reproducibility, or production. And so instead of, again, saying, oh, well, it works on my machine, it's like, this keeps happening to me, it works. Someone goes, it works on my machine. I'm like, well, I cannot run this. And so it really helps with that, where instead of sending me code, someone can send me a whole Docker file, and I can just open that, and then the project is there exactly as it is on their machine. So all of your code, your packages, your R, your Python, your libraries, your operating system all gets dumped into the Docker container. And depending on what you're running, you could even skip like the operating system or the system libraries, and you would just be running, there would just be like a little Linux kernel running with R, Python, or whatever. Some examples would be if you're publishing, instead of providing code, data, and describing the environment used, you could include a Docker file so anyone could pick up exactly where you left off. I think this has some really neat applications for just like reproducible research in general, where instead of saying, here's my code and my data, you can replicate like the entire environment, which is really neat. If you have a project at work that needs to be interacted with every week, no matter who looks at it or when, again, super relevant to me at work, and it makes me cry every day. And you're publishing an R package and want to test specific features across different base R or package versions. I'm sure there are automated ways to test it, but if you want to have a bunch of different environments to test it and debug it and hopefully write your different versions of your package for different base R versions, then you could have different Docker environments for each one. And that would really help things along rather than going into like the R Studio settings and changing your R version every time. And so there are some words of caution with using Docker. It's limited to the resources you give it. And so if your dev machine is less than awesome, your Docker container will be much less than awesome. It's sort of like if you had a whole pie and you start dishing out slices to different people, then you don't have a whole lot of remaining pie to like give to other people. Docker is only allowed access to what you give it, and it may take some extra work to get running. And that includes like your network, your system folders, really anything. Again, because it's a little mini virtual machine, you need to give it everything it needs access to outside of the container. Some workplaces might not be comfortable with Docker, again, because you usually need lower level hardware access to create a virtual machine. And some use cases may require direct access to the hardware and are incompatible with a container system. This largely is because some computers do math differently. Hopefully not a problem, but if it is a problem, you probably know that you have this problem. And containers require proper setup. So a lot of the times it's easy to just open an instance of RStudio or a Jupyter notebook and just start with containers. You actually have to take a little bit of time and set it up. So diving in, I actually split out, because I'm starting to get into Docker myself, I'm going to go through Docker run and Docker compose, where Docker run is, or I guess Docker compose isn't in the book. But Docker run tells Docker to run the following image, which is whatever you give it. Options are configured as needed. And then the image is configured as user/image when pulling from Docker Hub, which is like CRAN, but for Docker. And so here's the example run command from the book, and I'll go through the anatomy of the command in, I think, two more sections. But there's also Docker compose, which is similar to Docker run, but it's a little bit more, it's structured as a file, as a YAML file. It's a little bit easier to combine multiple services. So if you wanted R and Python, it can be used with the run command, which will start it and do something right away, or up command, which will just sort of open it up so it's ready to do something. And the options are similar to Docker run. I ran this line through a containerize website, or sorry, composerize website, which translated this to a Docker compose file. And then in order to run it, you would change your directory to the project directory, and then you use Docker compose up. And because everything is named Docker compose, it knows which one to open, because hopefully there's only one. I'm actually not sure what happens if you have more than one. So something to find out. Then you have a life cycle. So maybe you've built your little mini Docker container and you're like, okay, what do I do with it? You want to change the Docker file, not the image. And so you're like, what's a Docker file? I promise I'll get there. But it's a more complicated way to describe a container than just your Docker compose file. And so images can be shared like code. Think Git, again, because this is all about environments as code. You can run diff on your images if you want to. You can push, pull, commit, do whatever you want. And there are services to provide private image registries for companies. So if you're working at any size company, I guess, and you're like, I want to share this Docker image across multiple teams, then you could push your version of the image up to your company's registry. And then Joe Schmo on the other team could pull it and use it on their machine. And containers usually auto-pull if it doesn't exist already, which is pretty neat. So if I were to go back here and just hit Docker run and run this, Docker knows, oh, I don't have this on my machine, and it'll go pull it for me. So diving into the Docker run command, again, Docker Hub containers are in the form user/name. So in this case, that's AlexKGold/plumber. And you can tag an image with a version number using a colon and then a version number. It's sort of like website ports, if you're into that sort of thing. The --rm will remove the container once you kill it. And that's usually only something if you're testing the container, because otherwise, like if you're running in production, why are you removing your containers? It doesn't really make sense. -d runs in detached mode, so the terminal is free for other uses. So I don't know if you guys have ever run things out of the terminal. Sometimes it'll tie up your terminal and you have to open a new window. Sometimes it won't. Detached runs it in a new window. -p, and then you've got your host and your container, publishes a port from inside to outside so that you can set up your proper networking. Probably not a lot to worry about as you're getting started, but if you're working in any sort of like larger company, it's something to worry about a lot, because usually ports will get blocked, or your IT department will have strict rules. --name will assign a name of your choice. In this case, that is plumber. And then -v gets, this is actually not in the command, but it was in the book and it's pretty neat. Will expose an outside directory to inside the container. And you can use, it looks like regular bash directory structure. So $ and then in curly braces, PWD is your present working directory, which is generally your project folder. And then if this gets a little bit too complicated, you can go, oh, I can build a Docker file. It's not the same as Docker Compose. And it's structured a little bit more like a script than, whereas Docker Compose is a YAML file describing something. So you start with from, which is the base image. You have run, where you can run any command as though it's using the terminal. And then if you're using something fancy, you may need to install it first. So if you have, like, let's say, PySpark installed on top of your Python installation, you would need to install that before running anything with PySpark. You can copy a file from the host to the container, and then command will run a command at runtime. So something really neat that I didn't know before reading the chapter is that containers have layers, just like how onions have layers. And if you change a line in your Docker file, it will only rebuild from the topmost line that was changed. And so if we go to this example Docker file from the book, if I were to change the install system packages line, Docker knows that none of this changed and it will only redo everything from that line down, which should hopefully save on build time if you've got a whole bunch of stuff downstream or upstream. And then lastly, to build it, you do docker builds -t and your image name, which I cannot remember where in here that lives. I think that might just be the name of the Docker file. Might, not sure though. And then trying out Docker. So I know I sort of blew through all of like the book stuff, and that's because I'm going to share a different screen and then we can walk through some of the Docker exercises together. If I can figure out, oh, never mind. You share stuff. All right, so is this all tiny? Neat, there we go. Okay, so this is, I've already downloaded Docker Desktop, and this is what you get. Back to that little bit about making sure your Docker has all the resources it needs. There's a little resources tab, and you can give it as much or as little as you want. I happen to have a lot of resources available. And so I gave Docker 8 CPUs and 12 gigs of RAM. But if, ooh, oh no, actually, let me do, I realize that you guys cannot see both screens at the same time, and I can't. So let me move this over. Great, there we go. So if we were to try out the plumber penguins from the book, I can copy this and pull up a terminal window. Paste that in. And the backslashes are just line breaks so that you can run everything on different lines and make it easy to read. And then if I run it, it'll say unable to find image locally, which is true. I deleted it earlier this morning. And it's going to pull everything it needs from the Docker Hub repository. Depending on your internet and how big the package is, this could take a while. But thankfully, I'm pretty speedy. And so now I have a new downloaded image for Alex K. Gold, plumber, latest, where latest would just get whatever the newest version is instead of specifying a version. If I go back to Docker, I've got my new Palmer plumber, and it's running on port 8000. So if I go to that in my browser, whoops, let me do that in a new tab. Then I now have the Palmer Penguins API. Pretty cool. And so if we go back to the book, I can kill it with Docker kill. So if I go Docker kill Palmer, it's now been shut down. So if I check Docker, I don't have any containers running. And then I can go back to my local host. If I refresh the page, it's unable to connect. And so if I go run it again, I'm going to use my up arrow to navigate. I can run it again. It didn't go through the whole download because Docker knows I have the newest version installed already. So it'll just run it, give me this nice long string. I can check Docker, it's running again. And I go back, refresh the page, and there it is. And then if I wanted to poke around in that container, the docker exec-it will give me, it will let me run a command inside that container. And so if I run it, and then /bin/bash will give me terminal access. And so I can run it. And I'm now running in that container as root. Pretty cool. Lots of access. So be careful with what you do. And then you can, we can cat the API /plumber.r. And so cat will just, I mean, you're using r, it does the same thing. It will just print whatever is in that file to the screen. And so we've got this whole little API. So it looks like this is a Plumber API. You can run the API by clicking the run API button above, which I believe is in here. I'm missing it, but you can run, you're loading your libraries and you can see all of the different functions that exist in the Plumber Penguins. And so if you wanted to get a little bit more complicated, we could kill it.
You have to exit first, right?
Oh, yeah. Shoot. And then kill it. Sorry, I'm forgetting the next command I wanted to run. I had it ready to go. So if I wanted to run, use Docker run and run RStudio, which I think many of you are like, oh yes, I would very much like to do that. That's why I'm here. Then you could get an RStudio cloud instance if you're lucky, but those are usually very expensive. So you can run your own in Docker. And there's a project called the Rocker Project, which makes, they help get RStudio into Docker so that it's usable. And so if we were to examine this Docker run, we've got Docker run -rm will remove the container when we're done with it. -ti will give us access to the terminal. -e just lets us set an extra option flag, because when you open RStudio server, it asks for a username and a password. I'll leave that as your password. And then -p will set the port. The internal port is 8787. The external port is also 8787. The Docker hub user we're pulling is Rocker, and we want their RStudio image. And I already have this one downloaded, so this should be pretty quick. We can now see I have Rocker /RStudio latest running on 8787. So if I go here, I now have RStudio, which is very cool. I can log in and do password. And I've got a brand new little instance of RStudio running right in my browser. And I can do all the normal things. So I don't know about you guys, I always turn on rainbow parentheses right away because I get confused very easily. So I could do hello and set it to there. And I can do all of my normal R stuff. And then when I'm done, I can run Docker kill, or I can just hit stop. And it'll shut down my container. And then the big one that I haven't quite figured out, and I was hoping to have time to figure it out beforehand, is if I run it again, do I have all my stuff saved? The answer is not quite. And that's because I didn't set any of these things in my Docker file. So I haven't, if I had installed any libraries, I would need to reinstall them using the Docker file. If I had run any R scripts, I would need to do that. So if I had, let's say, environment variables that I wanted for whatever reason, I would need to source an R file and run those again. But if I go back to RStudio server, it's logged me out and I can do RStudio, your password, and sign back in. And there I have my online RStudio all over again. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. There's sort of like simultaneously a lot in this chapter to cover, but also so much of it is just, it really depends on what you're trying to do.
Right.
Or situation, so I can only really show so much. But I don't know if people have questions, or I can like try running more commands and show off more things.
But I'll just say that figuring out that you can put RStudio in a Docker container and just run it with a port was, it was absolutely mind-blowing to me the first time I did it, because what it opens you up to is also the ability to run VS Code in a Docker image, and to run Jupyter in a Docker image, and to run, like, you can, there are so many ways that you can get super creative with this. And to your point of, like, you know, just kill it and restart it with a couple of different commands in the Docker file. What I loved about that was that you could then like start with the Rocker or Studio image, but then you could also like build on top of it and say, like, you know, if I work in neuro imaging, then I want to have all of my neuro imaging packages, you know, loaded, you know, pre-built and everything. So if there's anybody who doesn't know how to do this stuff, definitely dedicate some time to this section, because it will become extremely, extremely useful the better you get at it.
I mean, something I sort of like glossed over is that, and I think I definitely meant to put it in and then forgot, is that when you build a Docker container, like, if let's say you've got your normal R project and you're using RENV and like it's working, it's fine, but every time you load the project, you have to wait for RENV to restore all of your package versions, and you sit there and you wait a little bit, and then it restores them and you can run your project. With a Docker container, you don't really need RENV, because your R package versions would be specified in your Docker file. And so when you're building the container itself, you're installing those specific versions, and you're not really considering the fact that other versions could exist. So it's a nice little headache saver. If you're like deep in the weeds on RENV and it's driving you nuts, you're like, you can just switch to a Docker file. And there are some tools that will print out your specific package versions for everything. So that, I mean, RENV does it, so that you know which ones to request.
Yeah, he does.
Still recommends using Renv, right? He says in it, like,
yeah,
if you don't use Renv, you might just package up like the latest versions. But like the best way to do it in R is with Renv, and then in Python is with virtualenv.
Yeah, it's, you could, it might be the best way, but it will certainly be a little messy.
I think it depends what you're doing, but like setting it up with the cache from Renv in your image, you know, that'd be a way to keep it from having to continuously redo everything.
Yeah, I just realized that it would be really neat for someone, probably me, or any one of you, to make an R package that could generate a Docker file from a current project.
I have. That does exist.
It does exist? Okay.
Yes. I it's figured called it would. Container it, like the word container and the letters IT, container it. Yeah. It's brilliant.
I really should have looked into this more.
It's a lifesaver. At least that's the one that I know. I think there's two, but the one that I know well is Containerit. And it's just been, you know, especially for, you know, the situations that you're describing, like I've gotten to the end of like, you know, a super long project or super long analysis. And I'm just kind of like, I really don't want this to break. So I'm just going to, you know, put it, I'm going to container it. I'm just going to put it in a Docker file and add anything else that I need. Like it doesn't, it's not 100% accurate, right? Like it's going to need some help, like knowing what your system libraries are, for example. So you hit container it and it builds the basic Docker file that would run all of the Renv and library installations, and then you just augment that a little bit and you know you're home free. It's great.
So for, I can share their site. I guess we can look at this a little bit too. But it only works if you have Docker. Wow. It's a little unsurprising. But this looks really neat. So you're installing from, oh, it's GitHub only, interesting. Okay.
I don't imagine CRAN, like I don't think CRAN would let you make a very useful version of this, like host a very useful version of this on CRAN because they couldn't test it without having Docker.
That's true.
And so, it would be hard to get this one on CRAN. It says build failing right now on their status badges, though. So that's not a great sign.
That's interesting.
They do have repo status work in progress, though. So I think, let's see. The last release is from 2019.
So yeah.
Sure.
And last update was 2021. But I've done, you can build Amazon Lambda functions from Docker images.
Mm-hmm.
I've done some playing with that with Vetiver. And there's a package, Lambda R, but it's by a Australian or Kiwi guy, so he pronounces it Lambda or Lambda, I guess. So that's most of what I've done with Docker before, and I need to get, I want to get better at using Docker for more things.
My use case, I actually have a server sitting down under the desk over there that runs a whole bunch of apps on. I guess they're Helm charts, so they're similar to Docker, but not quite. And I haven't quite figured out what the difference is, besides the fact that it's very annoying that they are different. But they're running with a layer Kubernetes cluster, so that if I had multiple computers available, then I could clusterize my containers. And so I've actually been running RStudio in that, which this is really fun for me, because while advent of code is going on, this means that I can run RStudio on my server, VPN into my home server, and then try and struggle to write R code on my phone while I'm out of the house. So if I'm sitting at lunch and I'm like done eating, I can sit and write R code from my phone. But that's all Docker. It's really neat, especially if you're trying new tools. So I know Docker,
So is Helm's built on top of Kubernetes, is it? Because I've never heard of Helm before.
Yeah, something like that. It's similar. So I can show you guys, but
I feel like this is like the picture of the universe, you know, that just keeps getting bigger. And
you're exactly. So
RStudio is everything. And now
I guess I can find the R. Oh, it might not be in stable. Okay, so if I were to pull up the RStudio chart, then we can look at chart.yaml, and so we see something very similar to Docker Compose, where with drag this out to another. And using Helm charts for me is more of a, the server software I use doesn't directly support Docker files. They support Helm charts. So I'm trying to find, there we go. We've got the Docker Compose. But it's similar, but not quite the same. And so there are ways to convert a Docker Compose to a Helm chart. And there's even a Helm chart that will let you supply a Docker Compose file, and then it will then run the Docker Compose. But there, like I said at the very beginning, I'll say Docker every time, but really there are a bunch of different chart applications. It's sort of how GitHub became the de facto Git software, Docker became the de facto containerization software. But lots of fun. I'm not sure. Getting into that, like, cluster computing is really something that I want to do, but it's kind of limiting if you don't have multiple computers to clusterize. And so I've been, I guess in theory, I could set up a virtual machine with multiple virtual machines inside of it and then clusterize those, but then it would just be turtles all the way down and it would be a little messy.
I totally agree. You know, one thing, you know, I just moved from an academic full-time job now to a PhD program. And I was fortunate enough that in that academic job, I had access to a cluster and I got to practice every day. But a lot of my colleagues in this PhD have never even had to SSH somewhere. And like the amount of time that it takes to learn that skill is not, it's not nothing. And just having that time to, you know, spend some time SSHing to a cluster, understanding how to submit jobs, understanding how to interface with long running jobs that you might need to parallelize and all that sort of stuff. Like, I just feel like when it comes to data science, this is another area that we're just not teaching from the get-go. We're teaching a lot of, you know, here's how to do a classification with empty cars, and then you post your little Jupyter notebook on medium.com and then that's it. But like, that's not data science. Like this part might not be, this might be close to data engineering, but as a data scientist, you need to know how to do this, some of this stuff. And so I've been thinking for a very long time about how to make sure that, you know, even the most inexperienced student of data science in general can try to, like, you know, put together a small cluster and submit a job for their empty cars with futures or something like that. That's not just, you know, dead simple and doesn't take any. So I don't know, just generally just the idea that like Docker and Docker Compose is too high level, I think is wrong. I think that we should find a way to open up learning about these skills and these tools and be able to introduce them sooner.
I agree with you. I think it's mostly a factor of how education has sort of been like siloed in a lot of places, where it's like, you're a data science student, so you'll only learn data science. Even if there's like a data engineering or software engineering thing that would be really useful for you to know, you're a data science student, so you don't get to learn it. And like, let's say, like, I mean, the Titanic data set is vastly overused, but if you said, here, I made my Titanic project using, let's say, like Vetiver, and I made it into a Docker file so that anyone can go download and look at my exact project and everything I did.
Right.
then there'd be, I would hope, enough value added there where it's not like, oh, geez, not another Titanic data set. It just, it adds a lot. I mean, that's really why I joined the book club, was I was like, I recognize that I did not know enough about this.
Yeah.
And I was like, I know enough of the words to know that it would be really useful, but I don't know enough about it to like do anything with it.
Yeah, I totally agree. All these words are familiar to me, but what they actually do is opaque.
It's, I know all the words, but when you put them together, it loses all meaning. So like using Docker at work is something I've been trying to do, but like I said, in the words of caution, some workplaces may not be comfortable with Docker. And so it's really tricky to sort of convince everyone, and hopefully this will help a little bit, but like, why should your workplace accept Docker?
Yeah. And
if you're doing a lot of like one-off projects, it might, you could even argue that the one-off projects are even more important to have Docker available because they're not constantly being maintained. And so if you're running something every week, you're going to notice when things start breaking and you'll be able to fix it. But if I write a script 5 years ago, and I think that would have been like R3.5 or something, and now we're here 5 years later, and like nothing works the same anymore. The tidyverse is totally different. You got all of the like the old tidyverse underscore functions. I went through a project at work recently and had to change over like 20 of those underscore functions to the modern equivalents because I can't go back and download and install the right version because I don't know which version the right version is because no one recorded it.
Right. Yeah.
And so using the Docker container, you can store all that information and it makes it really easy. And so instead of spending 2 days going through and making sure everything's set up right and updating all the code, you can spend 30, 40 minutes writing your Docker container once. And then forever and ever, people will be like, wow, that Gus guy is so great. He made Docker containers for us. And now we don't have to go through and update everything manually. But I don't know if there's more. I can chat about Docker probably all day because it's really cool.
Does anybody like practical examples they've used Docker things for? Like I was using it for a thing called Docano, which is like an interactive labeler. So when you're labeling data for models or whatever, you download Docker, install Docano, and then you can send it to your team to like label together. But that's the only time I've ever really personally used Docker in a data science kind of context.
Yeah, again, data science, I've been working on it at work, trying to get it spun up, but it takes a while. And then like at home, I'm running all of those charts on my servers. And I mean, that's been really useful because if I need to update something or whatever, then I can separate out all of my config files into one data set, or each app has its own data set, then I can go, if I break it, I can go kill it, remove it, download a new version, and just point that chart at my existing data set. And then I just open it up and it's all pre-configured and I don't have to worry about it. And getting over the, because when you, at least for me, when you first install them, they're all like self-contained. And the data isn't split out into that separate data set, but realizing that I could split it out has saved me so much stress because I'm not trying to back everything up and then like going through and spending like an hour reconfiguring everything. I have it split out, delete the bad one, install the new one, and it's ready to go.
Yeah, would you say, or would anyone like point out kind of where this is completely wrong, but most use cases I can think of, you could easily hand over a Shiny app or like an interactive markdown with multiple tabs and not have to go through the bother of getting Docker. At least like personally. And so I was trying to get my head around is like, when would you actually decide to take up the time investment to put something into a Docker container? And when would you not just send like an HTML kind of rendered R markdown or a shiny web app that links to a database or an API?
I would say anytime that you're working with somebody who doesn't like R, and there are a lot of such people in the world.
I was gonna say anytime something will have to run more than once ever.
Yeah.
Like if it depends on how time consuming and like what the time frame is. But like if you've got something that you're running like once a week or however often, then containerizing it so that it's stationary as things update.
And like if you're deploying a model or deploying anything else, that's anytime it makes sense to have an API, I think basically, then it makes sense to run that API via Docker so that you know exactly how it's set up. But I think the anytime you're working with someone who doesn't like R really does summarize why I was learning Docker and like why I wanted to have this book club. Was getting sick of, oh, we can't run that because, you know, you need to rewrite that in Python. I'm like, no, I don't. Like, we don't have enough people hitting it for it to even, for your arguments about speed to even start to come in. And like T-Mobile's chatbot for a long time ran off of Docker images with R. And I don't think we're going to get as much traffic as T-Mobile's chatbot. So stop it. Yeah.
It did.
Wait, sorry, what are you handing over in this case in the container? Like
it was models for tagging content, various things. It's hard to go into without going into things I can't go into. In my case, I was using it to set up Amazon Lambda API in a box, basically, that you hit the Lambda and it runs your API and returns the result.
So is it like you're envisaging it being used in a few years' time or something when people are unlikely to be using the right version of R, say, or whichever programming language? Because for most of those things, right, you just set up an API, use Plumber, or you like, as in it will work. In the short term, the big benefit of Docker is that you can actually control the version.
Well, that and for a Lambda, the way Lambda is like a serverless computing where it spins up the machine when the API gets called effectively. And so you can create them directly using Docker, and it's just how you specify what the thing is that it has to spin up. And it's nice because if you get it working that way, then you can run exactly what it would be running on your machine as well, and so you know can debug that way and all that. So part of it's the environment. Like I'm not running Amazon Lambda uses a very specific version of Linux that I wouldn't be running otherwise, and so knowing what's there, being able to debug what needs to be installed outside of R, all that kind of stuff to get it running, to have it ready. And then the reason that that's nice is that it's a cheap way to run something that isn't going to run a lot because it's a cheap way to scale. Like if it's not going to run a lot, it costs nothing. You have to hit some number of compute before it costs anything on top of like other AWS billing. But if it does suddenly get a lot of use, it just spins up more machines. And so it's like, it auto scales that way really cleanly and easily. But, you know, even like next week, a new version of dplyr could come out that changes something, and you're getting, even if you're just getting a warning message that's like polluting your logs, knowing that you're not going to get that new thing, you know, it's going to work the way that you knew it worked, is helpful.
Yeah. And then you can be deliberate.
It's like it takes 2 seconds with Rem, right? Whereas it might take an hour or some time to do it by Docker.
Not once you know what you're doing.
Version. Sorry, that is.
It takes time to learn to do it with Docker, but it doesn't, it takes no extra time once you've done it. Like once you've learned to do it.
Okay, yeah. So what they're like, say if you were starting a new project or something, it's not much time if you know what you're doing to write the container, like the setup file and everything.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So I kind of envisioned that taking a while. And then it being like, if you're going to do something a lot or something's going to be used a lot, then that setup time is like worth it.
That Docker container is very likely to be like exactly the same from project to project, other than the thing that it runs at the end. So it's really, once that was a whole thing that I was going through, I can't give you a specific example because what I was working on is making it easy to do anything that we could spin up any endpoint really quickly.
Yeah, nice. I suppose it's just trying to get into the mindset of like when I could justifiably tell my boss, "Oh, give me time to learn Docker."
Right.
Because like I say, because then I can do this. And then if he says, "Well, you could just use Rend or an API," and no, because you can't do this. Definitely see, like, from using Docker, I can definitely see like the value in it as a thing. It's just whether it would be on like a very personal level kind of worth the investment.
Right.
So Jack, I can definitely give you a super concrete example. We had an investment in a vendor for some of our software. And this software was, it was about neuroimaging and some nonsense that I don't really like very much. but what they did do pretty well was that they gave us the opportunity to build our own neuroimaging analysis tools and then upload those tools to their platform. And so instead of like being a company that says like, "Oh, we're going to do all the analysis for you," they said, "We're going to give you some stuff out the box and then you guys can also develop your own." And now the problem that obviously shows up with that is that if I am working on a Windows machine and I decide to develop my own thing that does some stuff in Python and R and basic bash, and then I also have some MATLAB and like all sorts of things, that's obviously going to conflict with somebody who tries to download that same tool and do some analysis on their M2 MacBook, right? So the Docker image and the Docker containers were used by that platform. They just said, "Okay, if you want to upload something, you just need to follow our argument structure for Docker, and then we can wrap it up in the GUI for you." And that ended up being really useful because it meant that anytime that somebody wanted to create something that included, like I said, it might've started with MATLAB and then it has to go to R and then it has to go to Python. And then the entire report is generated in some visual GUI sort of thing. You can put those all in one Docker container. And the vendor just says, "Okay, great. As long as you have instructions on how someone can click on an image and drag and drop it onto a little text box, then we're fine. We don't really care." And it worked really well for us, like, especially considering the reproducibility crisis that so many fields of science are having right now. Very, very small and slight differences in decimal calculations can equate to very irreproducible scientific results. So that was another reason why like Docker is super, super common in fields where, you need that same, random seed, you need that same decimal calculation on a certain, Linux random number generator kind of thing.
Yeah, I can definitely see the point about Windows and Mac. Like if you're shipping something out to, you don't really know who, and you just want it to take care of that across operating systems, like definitely seems really, really powerful.
And you go from, and that's not to say that, like, you know, people are unable to install stuff cross-platform. Like, I could write all of the documentation in the world for you to write. Like, I could go out and buy my own Windows, my own Mac of multiple versions, and like just write the documentation and people could follow it. Or I could just have a one-stop solution that's just one click or one line of in the terminal, Docker build so-and-so, and then call it a day.
Jack, to your question about like how do you ask for time to learn Docker, to me, one of the neat things is that like with a Docker run, you can start by just doing like Docker run and then the image. You spend like 5 minutes at the end of one day just messing around with like Docker run and Docker kill. And then the next day you start adding like one or two more things into it. And so you're not using like it's not like the kind of thing where you really need to like sit down and just like do it in one go. You can sort of just like, if you have like a few minutes here and there, you can just sort of like try something out, see how that works real quick. And then if you run out of time, then you can just try again the next day. Whereas with like bigger installs, like if you're trying to install Spark, it's not the kind of thing where you can just like try it. It's like, it'll be a little time consuming to get the whole thing like ready and set up.
Yeah, nice. And I think if you're doing a bit, if you're using the command line quite a bit and you build packages, so you have to be used to YAML and stuff, seems like there'd be quite a lot of like transferable skills, which would be nice.
Yeah, especially if you've been using Quarto, because I know a lot more of the Quarto stuff is YAML based than I think
the older. Yeah, I've used it a bit, but package down and stuff. You have like your YAML folder, right? And like,
yeah,
get into that kind of thing.
But their Docker, the Docker website has some really good documentation for using Docker Compose and like creating a Docker file. And they seem to have two different sets of documentation, which was a little strange. I mean, not strange, but confusing. But they've got some really good examples on running everything. So like this Docker Compose, I actually happen to know that that corresponds to this little Redis like trial guide. You can just hit run, and this is the Docker Compose for that trial.
Mm.
But their stuff is really neat, and it's extensive. And because Docker is so commonly used, everyone has their own Medium posts about it, or their Stack Overflow questions about it, and.
Yeah, it definitely feels like a read the docs kind of moment.
Yeah. Or even like, because it's all containers and it's all code, you can just go look at someone else's like Docker project and you can look at their Docker Compose or their Docker file. It's not like I need to see like an image of their machine to understand what they have installed. It's all just in the Docker file and you can just go pull that instead.
So. And the ability to do Docker Compose up or Docker run once, it just shortens a lot of the startup time. Like if I really wanted to rebuild, you know, Gus's project from scratch or whatever, I might have to go through Renv. I might have to change my R version. I might have to, you know, get all sorts of different things running, but a Docker Compose up or a Docker run, that's, you know, that's always going to be one step.
I think the longest part, if you handed someone a Docker run or a Docker Compose, the longest part would be the first run and downloading everything. But once you do that once, then you're good to go.
Yeah, it seems to work fine with like MX Max, right? Like there was a note in the book about you might have problems with Apple Silicon, but maybe I was just quite lucky, but I didn't run into any problems when I was installing it way back on the M1 Mac.
Yeah, they've been making a lot of improvements, but But you also, there's a, I don't remember the way to test it, but there's a chance that it was running like on a fallback to x86. I think the bigger,
run through Rosetta or whatever.
Like, exactly. Yeah. I think the issue here would be that it's not getting containers working on Apple Silicon, but finding software that is meant to run on Apple Silicon. Because even if you're passing through, it's still running on Apple Silicon. And that's sort of, I think, one of the big distinctions with the virtual machine is you can pretend it's something else on a virtual machine. On Docker containers, it's more just allocating resources. So. These, if you haven't had a chance, these things are very fast and lots of fun.
They're great. Like, and there's a lot more support in like PyTorch and TensorFlow for them now. And the like native build of our studio for the Apple Silicon is like, it works and stuff. I love them. I think they're incredible, like bits of kit, even on like an Air compared to a MacBook Pro, they're just ridiculously good.
I don't know. I think we're running out of time now, which.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Took it right to the hour. So excellent. Just real quick, let me pull up our schedule. So we are off for the next 2 weeks. And then the idea is that first week of January, we'll talk about what has changed since we ran it. There's been quite a bit. He's been following behind us a little bit and cleaning up. And I need to sort out when he's available to make sure that he can come and basically how long that's going to take. I might try to get him to come to that one, the session on what has changed. And then if so, we'll start section two on the 21st of January. So yeah, to a large degree, you guys don't have to worry because I'll be doing the next session no matter what. So, all right. So I'll see everybody in 3 weeks and have happy holidays and have a good new year.
Yeah, you too, man.
All
right. And you. Cheers, Gus.
Thanks a bunch. Thanks, Gus.
See you later.